Welcome everyone to my new show, The Curious Shah. My name is Kunal, and you know, in this show, I invite you to join me on this journey to learn and understand about important topics with my guests through my discussions with my guests. And my guest today is Professor Martha Minow, and it just feels surreal to just even say that, to be honest. But you know, Professor Minow, I'll just keep it simple and just talk about three facts about her career. One, she was the dean of Harvard Law School from 2009 to 2017. And she has been a professor at Harvard Law School since 1981. And if I may add, she has obviously had many a brilliant mind as her students. And if I can name drop here, one of her students, Justice Elena Kagan, a sitting justice in the Supreme Court of the United States. And of course, another student who went on to become the 44th president of the United States, President Barack Obama, just to mention two of her students. But, you know, I also want to briefly touch upon the fact that is so awe-inspiring to me is her vast and diverse background in terms of the areas in which she has worked, meaning like she has experienced working with refugees and also, students. And giving access to students with disabilities. And I'm nervous here, mumbling here, but I encourage the audience here to check out her background. And having said that, Professor Minow, I just want to get to my first question here to you about, so your book here, Saving the News, you have posited that there's a crisis going on. And I think you mentioned that it is a matter of life and death. And so if you could please just set the foundation here, what is your argument for this book? What is the crisis? And welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. It's an honor to be here with you. And thanks for the kind introduction. My book does focus on the United States, although I know the problems are global. And the crisis that I describe is the decline of the industry that has provided reporting on news, journalism that aspires to be truthful. And in the United States, there is a major collapse, particularly of the local news. And it's ironic because in the when Alexis de Tocqueville, the Frenchman who visited the United States in the first part of the 19th century, wrote his great book, Democracy in America, he was repeatedly describing the role of local news and the degree to which people living in this then new country were informed, even if they lived far from towns or cities. And fast forward to the present, we have half of local communities in the United States have at best one news, a local news source. Many have none. And we instead have the rise of the internet platforms. And there's a causal connection because the business model of the news industry has, at least for the last 150 years in the United States, has really relied in part on advertising and part on subscriptions. And the internet social media platforms have grabbed all of the advertising, really almost 80% of the advertising dollars, and also offered what they provide allegedly for free, although it's not really free because we all turn over our data. And then we are the product. But in any case, that has affected people's willingness to pay for news sources, and along with the decline of the advertising dollar, that has really collapsed the industry.
Right.
Of those local news outlets I mentioned, many have at best one employee or a part-time employee. And the national news is somewhat better, but not 100%. Right. And we have instead seen a massive decline in the numbers of providers and also the rise of politicized news, which is not entirely new. We had in the early 19th century, newspapers were owned by political parties in the United States, but there were many of them, and people often would obtain copies of different newspapers and see different points of view. And now, whether it's cable news, broadcast news, other news sources, we have some that are really just an arm of the government.
Right. So as you mentioned, the decline and sort of almost a free fall in the legacy news industry here. And, you know, then you refer to the internet platforms that could be a potential cause. And I want you to spend a moment on what the activities, if I may, of the internet platforms that could be causing it, because I know you mentioned that, you said it's not sort of an oppression Olympics, meaning it's not about who's to blame or who's suffering more. But I think you used the phrase, it's a wicked problem, meaning there could be many underlying causes and not a single solution. But if you could talk about one of the causes, at least the internet platforms, as we move on to the solutions for this crisis, and that could help us, you know, give a perspective on the solution there.
Well, thank you, and thanks for the close reading. Yes, I think there are multiple causes at work, but the role of the internet social media platforms cannot be ignored. In addition to the two elements I described, the migration of advertising dollars to the platforms, and then also the provision of material for free, I would add the following. The internet platforms allow third parties to post content that is often copyrighted, and there is no payment to the originators of the content, meaning the journalists and the legacy media companies that provide some of this content don't get paid. And if they don't get paid, they can't reinvest the money in the enterprise of obtaining new news. Even when it is the internet platform itself that is directing people to content, they don't pay. So that's a further cause. In addition, in the United States, there is by law an immunity from liabilities that attach to all other media sources that's granted to the internet social media companies. It's called Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act. And it means that unlike the New York Times, unlike the Poughkeepsie newspaper, these internet platforms do not have to invest in guarding against defamation or fraud or consumer protection violations, because the law, the federal law, immunizes them from any kind of legal liability, which in essence is a federal subsidy, because these companies do not have to invest in the kinds of protective activity. And the result is the harms to those who use their platforms. And then just two more that I would offer. One is that the use of algorithms to target individuals so that when you look at your site and I look up mine, we get different kinds of material. That may be effective as a consumer retention strategy, but it means that there's ever more erosion in the shared reality. We don't have a shared reality. We see different material. We see different facts or alleged facts. And so we're less and less in the same world. And then the last element of the internet social media companies that I would suggest is part of the problem is the interest in keeping our attention means that they hire psychologists and they devise techniques to grab attention and to keep attention is even contrary to what people consciously want. It certainly escalates the sensational, it escalates the outrageous, and it amplifies hate. As a recent whistleblower testifying in our Congress made very clear, this is well known to Facebook, for example. It is not an accident And even when it's pointed out by internal critics, the company goes ahead and uses the same techniques because it helps them keep people glued to the site.
Yes. Yes. So as you mentioned, and you use the phrase that the digital platforms, it's time to treat them as responsible adults. And so as we move to the solutions, and, you know, I mentioned to my audience here that Professor Minow, you know, offers almost 11 different examples, but I want to touch upon two here. One, I want to get to Section 230, Communication Decency Act. And, you know, on one hand, one argument could be that it should be repealed completely. Whereas I think if you could talk about maybe could it be adapted to address the present scenario, you know, maybe make it conditional. And then if that's a better option, or maybe, you know, I think you mentioned the public utility infrastructure. If you could briefly talk about that, I think that is fascinating.
Well, thank you. I do think that there are many avenues for legal reform, even in the United States, where our First Amendment protection for freedom of speech leads some people to believe that the government simply cannot act with anything that touches on media or news. And a fair amount of the book is devoted to showing that that's simply not true, that we have had government action throughout the history of the country that ranges from antitrust action, subsidies, regulation, you know, careful to avoid content and viewpoint regulation. But yes, the two that you mentioned in my analysis have no constitutional defect. One is to repeal Section 230 or to modify it so that it's conditional on some obligations that attach to the internet social media platforms. Obligations such as provide a transparent, disclosed criteria for their content moderation, make available to users the ability to see why they're seeing some content and not other content. And an even further obligation could well be make them what some people are calling information fiduciaries, so that they have a duty to perform the role that, frankly, editors have always performed, which is to provide their own judgments about is something true, is it reliable, is it something that is worth sharing. So I prefer the conditional rather than just the outright repeal, but either is lawful because, after all, no other media companies have that immunity. So it's simply putting the internet platforms on the same footing. And yes, that's one of a bundle of recommendations I make that I call treating the internet platforms as responsible actors, as adult actors. If ever there was a justify once upon a time to insulate them from legal responsibilities because it was a brand new industry, the government wanted to encourage it, this is long past its due date. These are now among the largest companies in the history of the planet. They do not need protection from the government. And other approaches to treat them like responsible actors include enforcement of copyright law, enforcement of consumer protection law, the same rules that apply to everybody else. Yes. One of the bases for doing that is the second option that you point to, which is to treat the internet social media platforms as public utilities, the same way that the electric company, the water company are public utilities. Yeah. As I note in the book, there's only one private industry that's even mentioned in the United States Constitution, and it is the media. And I am absolutely not in favor of ending private enterprise and turning this into a government enterprise. We all have seen the dangers when the media becomes simply a tool of the government. But I do think that when there is a product that people need so much that they can't actually compete, and when that product also has a kind of structure that makes it hard for newcomers to come and compete. So there's not a full competitive market. That's a justification for treating it as a public utility, meaning it remains in private hands, the investors can obtain a profit, but there is a scope for regulation about guarding against the exploitation that comes when there is a kind of monopoly or oligopoly power. And I think that's well describes this circumstance.
Right. And so, as you mentioned, the transparency and sort of the shared reality, I want to get to one of my favorite solutions, at least, or the concepts, which is the fairness doctrine. And if you could just talk about that and also tie it with the First Amendment's right to receive, I think I just want to hear your views on that.
Great. So when radio and then television started, the US government, like other governments, created a licensing mechanism so that there would not be a traffic jam in the use of the airwaves, and made licenses available on the condition of the licensee performing certain functions and behaving with certain kinds of responsibilities. One of them was called the Fairness Doctrine, which required the licensee, when covering controversial issues, political matters, to provide a right of reply by a candidate or an official who was specifically targeted. And more importantly, in my view, to actually provide an array of viewpoints on controversial issues, not just one viewpoint. And that was the law for a long, long time. And it remains plausible when we deal with broadcasts. But when we move to the world of cable and especially the internet, the justification of scarcity is not present. And it was with the rise of those new technologies that the US government actually just chose to end the policy. It's still lawful, but they ended it saying it's not needed anymore because scarcity isn't a problem. I'm not sure I would bring back the Fairness Doctrine in its old form, but the concept is a good one. And going back to this idea of making the immunities for the internet platforms conditional or using a public utility regulatory framework, some of the norms that could be applied under either category would be that the platform has to make available, at least to the choice of a user, can I see some alternative viewpoints? And we now know with all kinds of algorithmic language programs, it's possible to catalog content to find competing sources. I describe in the book a group of undergraduates, students at the University of Chicago for a school project, came up with an algorithm to do exactly that. And while I'm sure they're very talented, I have no doubt that the engineers working at the social media companies could do something similar, even better, and even more effectively.
Absolutely. So, I want to tie this to some of the recent developments. Now, you mentioned the not just the Facebook whistleblowers revelations, but also more interestingly, the recent regulation passed by the Chinese government towards its big tech industry. And it kind of, some of it is, related completely to what we're talking about here. In fact, if I understand it properly, I think some of the proposals are very similar to what the Democrats are talking about in the House. So, what's your view on, obviously the US and China, it cannot be compared directly, but what's your take on China's stance there?
I'm not an expert on China, but I am watching it all with great interest. I think that every country is now grappling with the challenges posed by social media. I think the Chinese government has been troubled by the kind of monopoly power and the kind of profits that the large companies are making. And also, frankly, their control of the data. they have lots of information that, given the form of government that China has, the government would like to have, and probably is seeking more control in general. You know, people that I know who live in China or are from China say that the government is, of course, watching all the social media all the time. But people know that, and they develop codes so that they can communicate even on sensitive subjects. I'm not an expert, so I don't know how that works. And there aren't the concepts of privacy or free speech in China that I'm familiar with. But it is striking to me that they are struggling with this new creation, and not so differently than other countries are. You know, I think in your country, there are issues about the role of the government and the government using the excuse of guarding against certain kinds of social harms to favor one party over another. And at the same time, I mean, I just have to point to the fact that some US-based social media companies have allowed the posting of hateful and misinformation kinds of material that are associated with violent outbreaks right in India. And that's very worrisome. Similarly in Myanmar, similarly in other countries. And so the failure of the social media companies to come up with a better way to deal with disinformation and hate is producing genuine harm in the real world.
Yes. So, you know, Mr. Thomas Wheeler, the former chair of the Federal Communications Committee, writing for the Brookings Institute there, regarding the Chinese developments, you know, he refers to Harvard's Shoshana Zuboff, and she talks about how, you know, there's two types of internet, surveillance internet and authoritarian internet. But and then Mr. Wheeler adds that, you know, I like this statement, which is, a democratic alternative begins with asserting the long-standing role of the government to protect public interest. And so, you know, that phrase, public interest, you know, brings me to Mr. Newton Minow here, and you know, himself a former FCC chair, but to me, more importantly, the wonderful introduction writer of this book. And you know, you mentioned that he's said, you know, laws governing communication touch every person directly, you know, intimately and daily, more so perhaps than any other law. So if you could tie what we've been talking about through the lens of the public interest and you know, your views on that.
Well, thank you. Yes, I was incredibly lucky to be born into a family with my parents and my father, who is now 95, will be 96 very soon, was appointed as a young man to the important post of being the chair of the Federal Communications Commission by President John F. Kennedy. And therefore, in my household and throughout my life, we have discussed these issues of media. And I was very honored when my father agreed to write the preface to this book. Yeah. He emphasizes in that preface, as he has in all of his professional life, this concept of the public interest. It goes back to that period of the licensing process for broadcast, because the public interest is a phrase in the authorizing legislation. And for granting or renewing a license, the public interest has to be served. And my dad, Newton Minow, raises the question, where is the public interest now in the treatment of cable and of the internet? Why are people not talking about it at all? And there has been a kind of erosion of the notion that there is a public interest and that it's something that government can articulate and defend, really since the 1980s, when Ronald Reagan became president, and you know, when Margaret Thatcher became prime minister in England, that really represented a tide against government and in favor of deregulation in many, many sectors. And we're living with the consequences. Some have been good, some have been very troubling.
Right. So, you know, being the, I want to be considerate of your time. I mentioned 20 to 30 minutes. Is there, you know, any point that I obviously haven't talked about everything. I encourage the viewer, the audience here to, you know, check out the book. I think it's relevant to everybody here. But, you know, please give us some of your thoughts here on, right. You know, on the current state of affairs here.
Well, one or two closing thoughts. As you noted, I describe the rights of listeners or readers or viewers, and that is not the usual way to describe the freedom of speech, whether in a constitutional domestic law or even international human rights. And yet, as the United States Supreme Court has recognized and some international tribunals have recognized, the freedom that matters here is not just one way. It is to support the exchange of ideas, the exchange of information, and the receipt of information. Right now, we are dealing not with the problem of too little information, but the problem of too much, and the problem of non-curation, or curation that is so different for each person that we don't share a reality. And I do think that it is a danger, particularly in democracies, which depend on a public that is informed enough to be able to participate in governance, governance for their own interest, governance for the public interest, for the shared interest. And right now we have an erosion of even the confidence that there is such a thing as a fact, that we share a reality about the nature of COVID-19 or the vaccines. I do think that there's a role for the government to make sure that this crucial lifeblood of the flow of information and reliable information is enhanced and strengthened at this time. The First Amendment in the United States Constitution is on one far extreme in terms of protecting individual liberty when you compare other countries, certainly China, but other countries as well. But the ideal that it represents is an ideal that goes to the heart of individual freedom, but even more to the viability of a collective life that is founded on a shared reality. And that's in jeopardy right now.
Right. So, you know, Professor Minow, I just want to say, you know, just thank you for such a timely book, raising such important issues, bringing to surface important issues here. And, you know, all I can say is, you know, may you write many more articles and books so I can keep having you back on my show. But I want to say I'm just deeply humbled and truly grateful for you doing this. And the word that comes to mind is just for being so cool. So thank you for being so cool. And, you know, thank you for doing this.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the interest and the wonderful questions. Best wishes.
Thank you so much. Thank you.